I recently picked up these two Wonder Swans from a Japanese auction site, both listed as junk, which generally means broken. They're usually quite liberal with the term, so I'm hoping for the best. If they do have any faults, I'm hoping that the only one they suffer with is the most common one. A bad screen. And I'm not talking lack of a backlight. An issue that comes up a lot with handhelds from this particular period is screen burn. Not to be confused with the screen burn you'd get from leaving the same image on the screen for too long, but this. When I first started seeing screens like this, I was puzzled. Why would so many people be burning their screens with a lighter? Eventually I came to realise that it was actually caused by the degradation of the polarising film and the glue that holds it to the screen. Although some may be lighters. So after a quick clean of the contacts and popping a battery into the battery compartment, or magazine, they do indeed power on. Which is a great start, but as expected the screens are pretty bad. They actually look better on camera than they do in real life, which is unusual. You can even see it's delaminated in places, so I'm going to take them both apart and see what can be done about the screens. So it's not too difficult to open up. There are six T6 screws on the back, and the only tricky bit, I would say, are the two clips on the bottom, either side of the battery latch. So just need to be a bit careful when opening that. Like that. Then the ribbon cable for the screen just needs to come out of the ZIF connector. And once that's out, the main board can just come out. There are some sticky pads on the back, if it does feel a bit stuck. All the button pads, unsurprisingly, could do with a good clean. So I'll just set those aside to clean later. And luckily for me, all the buttons are the same. That's some good cost-cutting design by Bandai. So the way I tend to get the screens out of things like this is to give the plastic a bit of a wiggle. Not too much, obviously, as, well, the plastic is getting a bit old now, so it's probably a bit brittle, and you don't want it to break. But just enough to try and get a bit of movement on the double-sided tape. There's actually a bit of flex on the front lens, so you could push against that if you are stuck. Then you just need to carefully pry it out. It is glass though, so it does need a bit of patience. And there we go, the screen's out. It actually looks like the polarising film is completely detached and stuck inside the case. Which I wasn't expecting, as it should be glued to the actual screen. And there it is, that's the culprit. And it looks pretty awful. Okay, might as well take the screen out of the green one too. And there we go. Well, the polarizer's detached on this one too, so it must be a common problem. That's two for two. Well, the screen itself is also looking pretty poor. I'm not sure if that's still glue attached, or even just a bit of the film still on there. Okay, well I tried cleaning it off with some IPA, and it definitely seems like the film's still on there. So I'm going to go and try and slowly, carefully peel it off with this knife. Which, to be honest, I was expecting I'd have to do with the whole polarizer. And while I do that, let's talk about why it needs a polarizer on the front. The screen used in a Wonder Swan is a reflective LCD, much like the ones used in a Game Boy. And although they're not the easiest things to see at the best of times, due to it needing to catch the right amount of light, I think they're pretty clever the way they work. Assuming you know the basic principles of light, that is an electromagnetic wave, and that light produced from nearly every natural or artificial source has those waves in every orientation, in the direction of the wave. And a polarizing film aims to block out the light in all orientations, other than one. So if you have two polarizing films in the same orientation, the light goes through. And if the polarizing films are at 90 degrees to each other, then the light's blocked out completely. And twisted between the two, you get a smooth transition of the light decreasing. And that's the key to how these screens work. Okay, let's say I'm getting on removing that film. This is slow progress, but it is coming off, and with a bit of IPA and patience, we should get there. But you can see if I do a quick test, what I do have off, it's looking pretty good. And see if I turn the polarizer, you can see it actually inverts the screen. Right, going back. Knowing that polarizers can control how much light can pass through, what makes that show something on the screen? Well, it's reliant on one more thing. A very clever thing. The pneumatic field effect. The LC in LCD stands for liquid crystal, and when light passes through certain liquid crystals, it has a property that can twist the polarization of light. This means for this type of display, it's sandwiched between two polarizing films and has a reflector on the back. This is because there's no backlight, and it's the reason you have to sit in such awkward positions to play sometimes. The light comes in through the front and is polarized. It then travels through the liquid crystal and is twisted by 90 degrees. Then, that goes through the back polarizer, which is at 90 degrees to the front one. It's reflected off the back and travels all the way back through the way it came, through the polarizers, the liquid crystal, and back out to your eyes, so you get to see that lovely greeny screen. Talking of which, I got this new technique, so I'm going to be done in no time, but let's wrap things up. One more interesting property of liquid crystal is that if you apply a voltage across it, then it begins to untwist the light. This, combined with the two polarizers, gives you the same effect as just twisting polarizers. It will reduce the amount of light that can get through. So imagine you could apply these voltages to different pixels. Applying the correct voltage to a certain pixel could result in the light being blocked, thus resulting in a dark black pixel, because no light is being reflected off that back reflector. And if you adjust the voltages applied, you can control the amount of light that does pass through, resulting in that grayscale appearance seen in these displays. And for all this to work, you need to start with polarized light, as otherwise there'll always be something reflected back. So let's go back and put a polarizer on the front of this screen. I picked up some sticky back polarizers on Amazon. I'll link to the ones I got in the description. Then you have to cut it to size. I used the old one to make sure I got it right. The most important thing here though is to make sure you get it in the right polarization. It goes horizontally to the screen, and these polarizing films tend to have a line on to indicate what direction it's polarized in. And once it's cut to size, you can just stick it on. I double checked the screen was clean before by cleaning it with everyone's best friend, IPA. There it is. That's as good as it gets. Just reassemble it, and this one's done. Okay, you may have to take my word for it, but it is miles better now. So just the blue one to fix now, and for this one I've gone for something a little different. But first, it's a nice looking PCB. Almost as nice as one as you can get from PCBWay. That's right, PCBWay is not only a great place for PCB fabrication, but also PCB assembly. So if you're not up for soldering some of the more trickier components, they can come already assembled, delivered to your door. It's also a great place for 3D printing, CNC work, injection moulding, or even your sheet metal needs. So if you're working on a project and want to prototype something or even make a finished product, they've got you covered. My favourite part of the site is their shared project section, where there's an amazing number of guides, Gerbers, and CAD files to help you get a head start on your next project. And thanks to PCBWay, I ordered this IPS screen replacement, which came in this lovely box. It comes with a glass screen replacement and the screen itself. So if you're after getting a WonderSwan working again, but you're not after doing all that scraping, then this is probably the easiest solution. Unlike some aftermarket screens, there's no case cutting required, so it's easy to fit and just drops in. It does require more power than the original, so you need to solder some wires to these contacts. Also, it is a little thicker than the original, so these spacers need to be removed. And as a result of that, and to stop any shorting, I'll be putting a layer of Kapton tape on the PCB. To replace the front protector, it just pushes out, and then you can use some IPA to clean up the glue residue. The new screen already has double-sided tape attached, so you just need to peel it off and push it in, after the IPA is evaporated. I also took the protective bit off the middle, as I think to get it off afterwards it would have been a bit of a pain. Then when it's on, just give it a good squeeze. Lovely stuff. The screen also needs to be stuck in with double-sided tape. The kit does also provide the tape you need. This needs to be cut to size though. So once you cut the tape to size, as with all double-sided tape, you just peel off the back and you can stick it down. You just got to peel it off. Okay, quite clearly I forgot to peel off some of that double-sided tape. I'm even pushing it like it's going to stick. I only noticed during editing, so it's a bit depressing. But I'll go back and fix that later. But to be honest, it hasn't really got that much space to move, so it's actually not too bad. Anyway, now the screen's in, you just need to solder up the two wires to the battery connector so it can get the power it needs. Then connect the screen with the ribbon cable provided. It is straight, so a bend is needed. And the last bit is this little square attached to a wire, which needs sticking inside the case. I'll explain what that's for in a minute. And before doing any kind of test, let's reassemble the whole thing. Right, here goes. Let's pop a game in and see how it looks. Oh. That's better. Wow, that is a massive difference, and honestly, it looks amazing. And that little square I stuck in terribly wonky, which no doubt will drive me mad later, well, that cycles through the different modes, or colours, in case you have a preference. I think I prefer the standard grayscale one best. It's still got a screen protector on. Oh, beautiful. Look how good that glass looks too. This looks great, and the glass on top is really setting it off as well. Okay, that screen on there is night and day to the original. I'm glad I've got an original in my collection, but for playing games, I'm definitely going to be using this new screen. So, would I recommend this upgrade? No. Okay, let me put it in some context. It really is a great upgrade. The screen is fantastic, and it's crisp, and it's easy to install. And if you have a WonderSwan original lying around at home that you really want to upgrade, then it probably is a good choice for you. But there is a downside. It's expensive. I mean, this screen costs £50, which is more than I spent on the two WonderSwans together. And there are other options. A massive factor in this price is that the original WonderSwan, as I'll call it, was only out for a year before being replaced by the WonderSwan Color, which had backwards compatibility with the original. As a result of this extended library, it became the popular choice with enthusiasts, as you could play the original and the Color games all on the one device. And due to that bigger community, results in a lot more options for upgrading your screen. And with more options, comes lower prices. You can probably pick up an IPS replacement screen for a WonderSwan Color for around £15. Added with the WonderSwan itself, it definitely comes in lower than this. So it means you've got a bit more money to spend on that extended library of games. So that's my advice. Look for a WonderSwan Color and a reasonably priced IPS screen replacement to pop in. Unless you're lucky enough to find a WonderSwan Crystal at a good price, as that came with a pretty good TFT screen at release. Or you're weird like me
and you just want the original ones anyway. Thanks for watching.